has something special for you back there that you can use throughout the service today. And look at as we talk about the church throughout the week with the staff and the other leadership here at the church are the children that are in our midst. And so we get to see them grow and change, and we get to see them impacted through the lives of so many different volunteers. So Angela, as our children's director, volunteering her time to do that, has put together these bags. And if you don't get to see one, you should take a look at them. They're filled with all kinds of activities and crayons. Sharpened and crayons for them to use, along with mazes and puzzles, and all geared towards different ages of kids. So it's an amazing gift for them all to do these stories and things that are Bible-based and often themed through there as well. So we're thankful for that, for the many different volunteers. Why don't we take a moment and just pray together before we begin the message today? Heavenly Father, as I come before you this morning in prayer, as we come before you, I ask that you would open our hearts and minds. For myself, yes, I ask for strength, for clarity of thought and mind. It's been a long day already, as you know. God, we just ask that you would work in and through us. We're so thankful for the words that you give us in your scriptures, and thankful for the opportunity that we have to come together and gather and learn. And I'm grateful. Last week I began to talk a little bit about relevance, about the things that we should be about as a church. And I defined that word for us, because often if you read any different church literature, you can read about churches whether they should be relevant or not. And ultimately when we think about that, if we think of things like the music that is played or the clothes that the people wear on stage or the way that the building looks, and those have really little bearing on the question of relevance. Relevance is defined, and I put it in your handout there, simply as bearing on or having reference to the matter at hand. So if we want to be a church that is relevant to the culture around us, it matters actually really little the kind of music that we play, whether we wear a tie or don't. It matters little whether we sit in wooden pews or chairs, or in a building like this, or meet out in a park. What matters is, are we reaching people where they have their deepest need and the way God wants them to be met? Are we being relevant? Are we having any input into the things that matter to them, the things that they hold in their hand, questioning day in and day out? And as we talked about last week, there are different ways that that happens, but I think the greatest way that our culture is screaming out that our community is desiring to be reached is around the matter of love, of being accepted, of being cared for, of engaging with people who really love them in a way that they were created to be loved. And we talked about how we see it in movies and TV shows and media, whether it's stuff that we find online or as we're scrolling through Facebook or looking at posts or pictures from all over the place, we see a need for people to be loved. We see people crying out. We see people wanting to have that question answered. I think ultimately it's because God created us with that need and that desire. That there is something within us that's in our DNA, if you will, that knows that there is something bigger and greater and something so special out there that can only be fulfilled by a relationship with Jesus. And that comes through his great love for us. And so we should, and in many ways we are relevant, but we can continue to grow in that as we talked about last week. Continue to have a bearing, continue to have reference, continue this week. I want to go a little further and just talk a little bit more about what it means, or how do we show God's love to the community around us. So how do we talk about this matter at hand, if you will, about being loved? Remember, it's all ages and all stages and all nationalities and all people. If we walk out of our building this afternoon and instead of just kind of having tunnel vision as we walk or drive away from here, we begin to look around at the see all ages and all stages and all nationalities that are represented right here in our city and in your neighborhood, wherever you head home to today. People want to know how to answer that ache within their soul and within their heart. They want to know how, why it's there, and what they can do about it. And they want to ultimately get to know the person who can answer and fulfill that need. They want to loved by the Creator, the Creator, and to love because of our Creator as well. The first thing I want to mention, and we talked about it last week, is that God does love us. And this can never be understated. We can't say this too many times, and we can't talk about it enough. God truly loves us. One of the first verses we would turn to with that would be John 3:16, which many of us would have memorized, that God so loved the world, you and I, that he gave his only son. He loved us so much that he gave his son, and as we understand the gospel story, he gave his son to the world, not just to get to know him, but to come and die for us, so that our relationship with him could be restored. God loved us so much that Jesus came and died for us and for the sins that we have committed in order that we may be forgiven because of what Jesus did on the cross, so that we can stand in a relationship with God in heaven. God loves us so much. And we need to remember that he loves us, and he loves us exactly how we are right now. does love us, and it can't be understated. But what does God's love look like in Scripture? What do we see, and how do we see that portrayed? He wants us. He's always pursuing us. He loves us so much that he desires to be in a relationship with us, and always has throughout Scripture. But it was in our own human nature, through what Adam and Eve did, that they chose to obey and eat from the one thing that God had told them would break that relationship. And they did it even though they knew the consequences of that relationship was broken. But God, it says in Scripture, knew even before that happened, he had a plan to restore and to redeem in Jesus Christ before that ever even happened. And he has been pursuing us ever since that day. He wants you and me to succeed in life. And that's done through being in a relationship with him. And we can succeed because of him. And by succeed, I don't mean big business or a great job. I mean succeeding in the things that God created us to do. He created us for a reason and for a purpose and for who we are, because the world needed one of you and one of me. And when we restore our relationship with him, it begins to open new doors so that we can live in that relationship with God, doing the things that he created you to do in this life. So for each of us, and it's different for each of us, thankfully, or else it would be a boring place to live. He created each of us for a different reason. And he wants us to succeed in that because he loves us. You know, it goes beyond even the idea of success. God, those ways, God, throughout Scripture, has always told us what we can do or shouldn't do in order to live a life that goes along with God's original design, his original way he wanted us to live. We can see it early on in the Old Testament and all the way through to the New Testament. Often, people will say, when I'm talking with friends or family, don't go to church, they say, you know, These are my own offspring. But they're like, just hold me. Whatever that is that's coming out of your mouth, stop. And that is no joke. It's absolutely true. So he did not create me to stand up here and sing. Thank you. also loves deeply and shows great grace and mercy to those who have never heard the truth before, or who have been told the wrong things. So whether it's a tax collector, whether it's a little man up a tree who invites himself over, whether it's a rich ruler, or whether it's the great grace he showed to a woman who met him at a well in the day, who had had five husbands and was now with a man who wasn't her husband, and he opened up the doors of the kingdom to her. He was moved by the people and the situations. He had great empathy for them because of his great love for them. So the question is, can we live the same way? What does it look like for you and me to take some of those things into our own life? Do we love people enough to confront their sin? And I don't mean standing there with a Bible. You have this picture of beating them over the head. I mean a brother or sister who you come alongside of. Not only point out their sin and help them to walk through that to find redemption and forgiveness. Because it takes great love to point out sin in a way that is helpful. But it's necessary. Jesus did it. Paul did it. We need to do it too. I would argue that it is far from loving to stand there and yell something across a room or a street corner or hold up a sign and tell people that you have no relationship with. It can cause a lot of harm. Does that mean I'll be careful? I think that we need to remember that love is shown through relationship. That doesn't mean that I think that we need to keep quiet about what we believe sin is or isn't, or that we shouldn't be bold with our proclamations. But we also need to remember a place of love and grace, and bring it from a place of mercy and trust. Can we love people enough to confront their sin? Can we love people enough to accept them for where they're at? Everyone is somewhere along their journey. They may be close to God, they may be far from God, they may look just like you, they may look completely different than you. But God loved them and loves them for who they are. He wants so much more for those who are far from Him and for you and me too. But He loves them for who they are. Do you think that we can love in that same way? Do you think that we can love the way that Jesus did? There's a passage, or actually a really great passage about the love of God and what happens when God moves His people back into a place of blessing. It's a passage that speaks of evangelism and outreach of justice and grace and love done in God's way. And it's in Zechariah chapter 8. I want you to turn with me there. If you have a Bible, you can open it up. There are a few Bibles in front of you as well. And Zechariah, you can find in the table of contents, or you can than that, they will say to their neighbor, you see what's going on